Hey team, Tim from RaceCraft here. Welcome to today's members webinar. Today we're going to be talking all about making use of electronic setup sheets in your data logging to help you get a little bit more out of it. Before we get into that, I'm just going to do a little bit of a pre-show like we normally do. Talk a little bit about what's been going on around the shop. So as normal, our mechanic and our fabricator, Jimmy, have been going hard in the workshop trying to get our endurance racing car, our SR20 powered GT86 going. That has, we did a shakedown a couple of weeks ago on track, which was relatively successful, but we did have a problem with the fuel system. I actually had some pictures brought up here on my computer, which I can't show you at the moment because there was a problem with that working thanks to Windows there. But essentially we had some debris in the fuel system. It was made up of some small metal filings that were actually making their way past the fuel filters and actually made their way to the injectors due to a problem with one of the fuel filters that we found. Essentially what was going on there is we had one of the fuel pumps sending a whole lot of debris through the system, making some metal filings, which made a pretty big problem as far as choking up the injectors. Luckily the injectors themselves have some little filter baskets on the back of them to make sure no debris actually makes their way through the actual injectors, but we have had those sent away, flowed, and everything is currently back on its way back together, including we've got new fuel pumps sorry, new fuel pumps fitted, as well as a new set of filters in there as well. So we're hoping now that we're at the end of our fuel system dramas. The guys are actually putting it together right now as we speak, and it's about to go back on the dyno this afternoon. And the idea there is that we're going to get it back to the track tomorrow for another run, another shakedown, before we get ready for another round of upgrades on it. Essentially, we're just trying to run it on track as we go through and upgrade things to try and debug sort of each system or each upgrade as we go. So looking forward to getting back on track and seeing how much progress we've made there. So as always, guys, we've been putting out more socials content as far as lots of really tech heavy stuff. In particular, I want to draw your attention to a recent video we put out on YouTube. So over here on my laptop screen, this is a video of three common mistakes people are making under braking. So this is basically an example. I go through a couple of different examples of log data and look at what I would say are probably the three most common things that people are doing wrong and how you can use log data to improve those, which if you guys aren't already making use of log data, this hopefully something like this will encourage you to get more out of it. Certainly that's something we're going to be diving into in much more detail today, getting a little bit more sophisticated, but this is sort of more looking at the basic application of how you make use of braking data on track to get the most out of your car on track. Just jump across to the forum here. We've had plenty of questions and good questions and sort of discourse between me and some of our RaceCraft members. The question or the post I want to draw your attention to this time was on the discussion of brake ducting. So one of our members, Nick Windsor there, has got I think it's actually a Celica GT4 from memory. I've seen his post before. And he's actually retrofit a set of aluminium uprights to the front of his car. Interestingly, these are actually from a Gen 3 Prius, Toyota Prius, which I didn't actually realize have full aluminium uprights as well as a McPherson strut front suspension. So that's what he has chosen to upgrade the front of his car with. But the particular question he's got is all about brake ducting. So he was really just asking about what some guidelines are, how you go about sizing brake ducts, where you want to point the brake duct to actually get the most out of cooling out of the disc. So I've got an example here of I gave Nick a reply, but also gave an example of a picture example of what I was talking about. Essentially, what you want to do is feed the air into the inlet side of the disc. In fact, I'll just grab one here. There's actually one. I've got a prop here I can show you guys. If we have a look on the overhead, it'll make it a bit clearer. So this is sort of a floating motorsport style disc. You can see here it's designed to have a hat fitted to it. This is the part that locates on the hub, and it allows for some expansion and contraction without constraining the disc, and allows it to float on the hub, which is a pretty common motorsport style arrangement. But the point really I wanted to make about Nick's question there is, if you look down the top through the veins here, so you can see it's hollow. It's kind of a little bit hard to see, but essentially the point I want to make is that these vanes, if I look, make sure I'm looking in the right direction, are actually, if we look, they kind of look in some ways similar to the slots on the outside. The slots have got nothing to do with what I'm talking about, but the kind of the vanes look a little bit like this. And the idea here is that these vanes are designed to work like an air pump. And what I mean by that is that we want to feed the air into the inside of the disc. So the idea here when you're doing your brake cooling is you always want to feed the air to the inside face of the disc and exhausts out the top. Now what I mean, well not necessarily at the top, but at the edge, what I mean by an air pump is the way that these vanes are curved, which is a little bit difficult to see. Looking down the inside, you'll see a lot of factory vanes are actually straight. So what I mean by that is the vanes come sort of radially out from the center. That is one way to do it. It's nothing, you'll never really see any proper motorsport discs working like that. They've always got curved vanes. And the idea here is that the air is being pumped from inside to the outside. So as this thing spins, it's naturally drawing air from the inside to the outside. All of that goes to say that we always want to feed the air to the inside of the disc, not necessarily, not the face, just the inside of the disc, because we want to promote air getting from the inside to the outside. So essentially that was next question, where do I feed the air to, how big to make the hose? Now that question of how big to make the hose, that really is one of those how long is a piece of string questions. It really depends on the application. It depends how long you're running on track for, what the application of the car is, how heavy it is, how big your brake discs are, all that sort of stuff. But I sort of gave Nick a bit of a starting point there. I said roughly if you're using something like a typical say touring car or a GT car, on the front you would typically have at least sort of 3-inch hoses, so that's roughly 76 millimeter diameter hoses, one to each corner of the car on the front. That's sort of a starting point. And as I said, there's lots of different a huge variation. I've worked on cars that have had as small as maybe something like 2-inch of brake diameter ducting, all the way up to multiple 4-inch ducts, and still not have enough cooling capacity in them. So it really depends on the application, but if you're starting with something like a modified road car that you're running on the circuit, certainly something like 3-inch is certainly about the right sort of starting point. And you really just want to feed the inside of the disc. And the other point I wanted to make here was on this the sort of plate that's here, that's part of feeding the inside of the disc. This isn't an example of anything we've done. It's just something I found online which illustrated it pretty well. But essentially this plate here, it's got no other purpose than sort of blocking off the rest of the inside face of that disc. The idea is we want to promote as much air as possible to go through the inside of the disc, nothing really to escape from the outside. So that's all that's really doing. You ideally want this gap in here to be as close as possible. Usually down in sort of 1 to 2 millimeters range is ideal, just to make it essentially as sealed as possible without having any metal to metal on contact in there. So I thought that was just a post worth highlighting. I thought it was something that probably applies to quite a few of our members. So thanks very much for that question, Nick. So guys, as you're aware, we're always making new courses here at RaceCraft. Currently, we've got our Race Driver Fundamentals course, which is all about helping you guys improve your driving on track, and also our Motorsport Suspension for Fundamentals course, which is going to be, both of those are going to be coming out soon. Both of those are currently in the later stages of production, so we're looking forward to having those coming out. So if you're interested in those sorts of topics, make sure you keep an eye out because they will be coming out soon. Okay guys, that's it for the end of the pre-show. I'll be back in a second and we'll get right into the topic of electronic setup sheets. If you liked that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.